I'm sure you've seen the numbers. President Trump has the support of the Republican Party, the RNC. Some 90% of Republicans support Trump. And also, even his numbers went up after, or the support numbers went up for Trump after his feud with the squad. How do you compete against that when he has pretty much the entire Republican Party behind him?
Well, I think that's incontestable. I mean, I think that you're right. But I also think that when I talk to small business people in South Carolina, or when I talk to moms trying to get their kids to and from soccer practice, that there is a growing unease about the way in which, indeed, nobody's talking about debt deficit or government spending, and the way in which it can impact their retirement account, their savings account, ultimately their job.
Joining me now is Mark Sanford. He is considering a run against President Donald Trump. Mark, thanks for being here with me. So, Mark, tell me what inspired you to even consider the idea of running against President Trump.
I've been struck by the fact that nobody's talking about debt, deficit, and government spending issues in Washington, D.C. I was struck by the fact that I watched two Democratic presidential debates wherein not one moderator and not one candidate talked one sentence about any of the one of those three issues. On the Republican side, the president's ruled out action on the various things that are frankly driving our debt and spending numbers. And so I've had some time since I left Congress in January to really dig into the numbers. And we have one heck of a financial storm coming our way. I think we're walking our way toward the most predictable financial crisis in the history of man. And we're having zero discussion on it in Washington. And for that reason, I've said here over the next 30 days, I'm going to look at any way possible to elevate that issue. It could mean a presidential run against Trump. It could mean starting an advocacy group. It could mean none of the above.
Yeah, and I know that you're known as a deficit hawk, and I 100% agree with you that we're not talking about government spending enough. I mean, you rarely hear it from either side. But when it comes to reining in the federal government spending, sometimes maybe it's easier said than actually done. So what would your plan be, and how would that be different than what President Trump is doing and Republicans in Congress right now?
Well, tell me what they're doing. I missed that memo. I mean, they're not doing anything right now. If you look at our deficits, they're projected to rise to over $1 trillion a year over the next 10 years. Interest is the fastest growing category of federal expenditure. Interest will outpace even what we spend on national defense here over the next 3 years. It'll outpace what we spend on children on all federal programs here in a year. So I would respectfully argue with the idea of, quote, anything being done on it. I've always been a fan of what's called the penny plan. It's across the board 1%. It's based on the fact that until we recognize, one, that we have a problem, and two, that we got to do something about it, I think that what you have to say is, okay, A, it's a problem, and B, let's all get in the boat together. Until then, what it becomes is Republicans versus Democrat, urban versus rural, my stuff versus your stuff, and nobody will cut a penny. Everybody fights to the death on hanging on to whatever they've got. So I think that the first part of the equation is to say, do we in fact have a problem, which I don't think many people agree on. And that's the premise of this next 30 days, to say, yeah, we got a real problem. It's as real as a hurricane coming on off the coast of South Carolina. Things look sunny right now, but when that storm comes, we have a profound financial conundrum.
Where do you think we'd be today if we had a Democrat president, had Hillary Clinton won the election in 2016?
Who knows? I mean, how many angels dance on the head of a pin? I don't know, and I don't particularly give it a lot of thought, given it's not one of the things that I control. So, I mean, I don't know where we'd be. You tell me.
Okay. And so I know that, I'm sure you've seen the numbers. President Trump has the support of the Republican Party, the RNC. Some 90% of Republicans support Trump. And also, even his numbers went up after, or the support numbers went up for Trump after his feud with the squad. How do you compete against that when he has pretty much the entire Republican Party behind him?
Well, I think that's incontestable. I mean, I think that you're right. But I also think that when I talk to small business people in South Carolina, or when I talk to moms trying to get their kids to and from soccer practice, that there is a growing unease about the way in which, indeed, nobody's talking about debt, deficit, or government spending, and the way in which it can impact their retirement account, their savings account, ultimately their job. And so I don't think you'd ever get institutional support on an endeavor like this if I pulled this trigger, but I think that you'd be surprised at how many people actually care about this. I mean, the Republican Party, I mean, with John Boehner's quote that I don't know where the Republican Party is. I think it's taking a nap somewhere. There are a lot of people that I've known over my time in politics who cared passionately about the rate of expenditure in our federal government and what might come next on that front. Those people have not disappeared. They still exist out there across this country, though they're not particularly making their voice heard, given the cult of personality that at times surrounds Donald Trump. I mean, you know, they say basically what I'm hearing at home, I like, you know, some of what he's doing on immigration. I don't want to have a porous border. I like the way he's pushing back against some of the Chinese, given the way in which they've at times abused the system. You know, I like a number of things. I like his judicial appointments. But I don't think that they like the way in which money is being spent in Washington, D.C. right now. And I do think that they want a voice for an alternative opinion on that front.
I mean, one could make the argument that President Trump and his administration, that's something that they could tackle in a second term. Wait.
But if you don't do it in your first term, and this is where you can pull up a clip of me and Mick Mulvaney getting into it on a budget hearing, because I used to be on the budget committee, wherein I said, these numbers are a lie. They're totally made up. They're based on wild optimism. So if you talk to Maya McGinnis there in D.C., you know, with the Committee for a Responsible Government, what she'd say is, there is no way that these numbers come about. And so the idea of saying, we're going to pretend this problem doesn't exist for a first term, but tell you what, we'll get to in a second term, is at odds with the reality that both of us have seen over the years in politics.
Yeah, but obviously there's a lot of pushback on both sides, and Republicans are to blame on the spending. And like I said, that's something that I'm concerned about, and I know a lot of Republicans are concerned about, and you've been talking to people that let you know that they're worried about it too. But like I said, you're challenging President Trump and you think you can do it better. But it, I mean, there's a lot of things that go into it. And so it's not just a one person deal.
I don't see that point, but tell me where he's talked about the debt and deficit being a problem. Tell me where he's not done the reverse. What he has said is that we will not touch the very drivers of our debt and spending numbers. That's what he said.
And Mark, you went over some of the successes and some of the great things that the administration has done over the past 2.5 years. When it comes to immigration, doesn't that all kind of play a role in your platform?
Yeah, again, I don't have a platform. I want to be clear. I'm exploring this thing over the next 30 days or so. If I do, then yeah, I'd have a platform position with regard to immigration and a whole host of other things that would be expected of any candidate. What I'd say at this point is I don't disagree with the idea of border security. I've voted, I mean, you can pull my votes as a member of Congress on that very front. I think it's important. I don't think you want to have a porous border. So I wouldn't disagree with much of his action on that front.
Yeah, I think that's one of the top concerns that Americans have is the border, and it's, you know, taking over the national debate.
That's the point. The border, at the end of the day, it's a problem. And again, I voted in accordance with securing the border. At the end of the day, it can't bring down our civilization. It's telling to me that Admiral Mike Mullen, who is the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, when asked, what's the biggest threat to America? Answers the national debt. It's telling to me that one of the co-authors of the Bowles-Simpson Commission, at the end of the report, says we're walking away toward the most predictable financial crisis in the history of man. Our problem is we're having much discussion on the border and immigration and what might come next there, but we're not having discussion on the very thing that could totally throw upheaval into people's job prospects, their savings, and ultimately the American way of life, and that's the debt, deficit, and government spending issue.
Mark, what do you say to your critics, people that are wondering about your motives for suggesting that you want to run for president against Donald Trump, suggesting that this is kind of like a publicity stunt to sell books or something like that?
I don't have a book.
Well, I mean, in the future.
In other words, anybody that has watched me over the last 25 years, and this wasn't my idea. I mean, it was a year ago that a friend called and said, this is what you need to do. And then other friends called and other friends called and other friends called. And for all the obvious reasons in the world, based on what you're suggesting, I said, thanks, but no thanks. But it kept coming. And so what hit you is in essence the thinking of one of my friends who said, Mark, you have almost 25 years invested in your life on these very topics. You know, whether this thing materializes or doesn't materialize, what is another year or a couple months of your life in if you might have just a small touch of being able to advance something you've worked on for 25 years? If we might even go have a small touch of being able to change the debate in Washington on how important debt deficit and government spending issue really is, and it's for that reason that I'm doing it.
Yeah, you mentioned something like an outside group, too. That's something that you would be interested in to focus on the deficit and government spending. Why wouldn't you just go that route initially?
Because I don't know that we'd be having this conversation right now if I went that way. You know, what I'm going to look at is which way leverages your time and talent and which way will more people come along with you in raising and projecting on this issue.